The Linden Tree by J.B. Priestley, adapted for radio by Mollie Greenhalgh, with Geoffrey Banks as Professor Linden and Kathleen Helme as his wife Isabel. The play takes place in 1947 in the northern manufacturing town of Burmanley.
Anyhow then.
Isn't this Professor Linden's study? It's Mrs. Linden I want to see.
Well, half the sitting room ceiling fell down yesterday. No warning.
Oh, dear.
I couldn't speak for 10 minutes. So you'll have to see Mrs. Linden in here.
Oh, well, I was afraid you thought I'd come to see Professor Linden.
Oh, no, he's at the college on Friday afternoons, always. Couldn't even meet the family this afternoon. They've just come in a big car all the way from London. Oh. Plenty of petrol, money no object. That's the son, Rex.
Oh, is he here?
Yes, with his two sisters, all smart as paint. She's showing them their bedrooms, all excited. It's the professor's birthday today. Watch out for that. Big change is coming. I'll tell Mrs. Linden you're here.
Thank you.
Oh, here she is. I've shown Mr. Lockhart into the study.
Oh, thank you, Mrs. Cotton.
Right.
Oh, Mr. Lockhart, I hope you haven't been kept waiting long. So good of you to call so promptly when you're so busy.
Oh, not at all. I enjoyed the walk across. The early tulips are out on College Green. Very pleasant.
All the children have just arrived. You know, Rex, Jean, and even Marion, who's come all the way from the very centre of France. So the whole family will be here this weekend, for the first time for years. Now, I want you to consider this little talk of ours as being strictly between ourselves. Very confidential. Even my husband doesn't know about it, and I'd much rather he didn't, if you don't mind.
No, of course not, if you really think
I do, most decidedly. It's about him, this little talk. And I'm appealing to you not simply as the secretary of the university, but also as a friend. Robert and I have always regarded you as a friend.
I'm very glad, Mrs. Linden. And, of course, if there is anything I can do...
Yes. Well...
Yes?
Is there a definite retiring age for professors here at Burmanley?
There was. 65.
Ah, I thought so.
The late Vice-Chancellor ignored it. And, of course, during the war it was very convenient to keep on the older professors. But now...
Yes, now? What is the attitude of this new Vice-Chancellor? He's not very old himself.
About 45, I believe.
I'm sure he doesn't want old professors.
Well, no. He doesn't.
Dr. Lidley and my husband don't get on, do they?
Well, of course they represent two different points of view. About the university, I mean. Totally opposed, really. Professor Linden left Oxford to come here, didn't he?
He did. Much to my disgust. Though it's all a long time ago. And he promised we'd get back to Oxford sometime. And look at us. But... Go on.
Well, he always wanted Burmanley to be as like Oxford as possible. Now, Dr. Lidley is quite different. You might describe him as a high-pressure educationalist.
Mr. Lockhart, frankly, I don't care tuppence what Dr. Lidley is. The only time I met him, he seemed to me to be one of those bright, beaming bores. And I hope I shall never see him again. And that... is what I wanted to talk to you about.
What, about not seeing the Vice-Chancellor again?
It amounts to that, really. My husband is 65 today. He ought not to stay here in Burmanley any longer. He's tired. He's been here far too long already. He'll never keep up with these new programmes of work you're introducing. If you want to do him a kindness, you won't oppose any attempt by the other side to get rid of him. Well, he ought to go. And although he's obstinate... he won't stay where he's not wanted.
But surely, if he himself...
Oh, won't you have a cup of tea? It's here, I think.
Well, no, thank you. I must be getting back to my office.
Family's just coming. There we are. I've told them it's ready, but I doubt if they had a word.
Stay in and say how do you do to Rex and the girls. Come in, children.
Hello, Mr. Lockhart. Remember me?
Oh, yes, of course, Rex. You're looking well.
I'm feeling quite remarkable.
Now, you girls remember Mr. Lockhart, the university secretary, don't you?
Yes, very well.
This is Jean. Dr. Jean Linden, if you please.
Hello.
It's on the staff of the North Middlesex Hospital. And this is Marion, who's come all the way from the centre of France because now she's Madame de St. Vaury.
Really an old-world French aristocrat who wonders what Burmanly is all about.
Don't be an ape, Rex.
It doesn't seem long since you were both schoolgirls. Oh, well, it makes me feel old.
You sure you won't stay to tea?
Oh, no, no, thank you. Well, it's nice to have seen you all again. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.
Oh, thank you so much.
I'd say that Mother's up to something with poor little Alf Lockhart. Mm. I saw it in her eye. What about some tea?
Mother'll want to pour out. Just look at that tray. If one of our maids brought in a tray like that, Rennie or his mother would have a fit.
This is Labour England, ducky, not your Catholic aristocratic old world with a nice black market on the side, and not Jean's new world. Well, Mother, what are you up to with poor little Alf Lockhart, eh?
Just a little chat about your father. Now let's sit down and be cosy. Tea, Marion,
please.
Oh, such a shame you couldn't bring the children.
It really wasn't possible. And Belmare was quite furious even when I said I'd like to bring them. We were talking about it one night last week when Father Honoré was dining with us. He's really very witty.
Yes, dear?
I'll tell you later. Don't let's bother about it now.
Marion's quite right, Mother. Only leads to trouble. She and Jean were at it on the way coming up in the car. And Father Who's It is practically a detonator for Jean.
Oh, well, really, Jean, if Marion wants to talk
about... I didn't stop her. And Rex is exaggerating as usual.
No, he's not. And if you're unhappy, Jean, it's not my fault, is it?
Unhappy? I'm not unhappy. What are you talking about?
Oh, come off it. I'm not one of your hospital patients. Do you think I don't know you? You're miserable about something, so you're taking it out on me, or trying to do, just as you always did.
There you are, darling.
Thank you.
Now, Marion, you shouldn't talk like that.
But it's true, Mother. And as soon as I say anything that reminds her that I'm a Catholic now, she says something hateful and hurting.
Oh.
No, Rex, I'm not going to start arguing all over again. I'm simply going to say this. I became a Catholic at first simply for Rennie's sake. But now I'm more than glad I did. And the more I see of the rest of you...
Marion!
No, not you, Mother. And of everything here, the more thankful I am that I am a Catholic and have a faith and belong to a community that may be old-fashioned, as you call it, but is still civilised. Now go on, call me a fascist again.
Why? Do you enjoy it?
Now stop it, both of you. If this is how you two go on, then I agree with Rex. There mustn't be any more of it.
I'm sorry, Mother. I've finished.
Is there something wrong, Jean? You're looking, rather strained, dear.
I've been working too hard, that's all. We're all overworked at the North Middlesex. We're terribly short of nurses and domestic staff. Short of everything, except patients.
Mm.
Oh, forget it.
Well, couldn't you apply for some easier post somewhere?
Not just now. But I would like to find something not quite so futile. Half the people we try to patch up might as well be dead. Only half alive.
I call that wicked. Yes, downright wicked.
I wouldn't call it anything if I were you, unless you're prepared to leave your delicious chateau and all your devoted peasants and take night duty for a few months.
And that's
girls,
Jean.
Turn it up. We were asked up here for an urgent family reunion, business and pleasure, I hope. And the Catholic communist debate is now closed for the weekend.
And Dinah and your father will be back soon.
Ah, how is young Dinah? Why isn't she here?
No, she's practising with the orchestra this afternoon and nothing would induce her to stay away. She's very well and happy, really. But still the oddest child you ever knew. More tea, anybody? It isn't very nice, I know, but poor Mrs. Cotton, who likes nothing better than making tea all day long, really hasn't the least idea how to make it properly.
Most of them haven't. They can't do anything properly.
Don't care for the masses, really, do you, Jeannie?
No, of course not. That's why I want to see them turn into sensible, civilised creatures. Oh, that may be for me.
I'll answer it. I'm expecting a call. Hello? Yes, dear.
Help yourself, darling.
Oh, thank
yes,
you.
Yes, speaking. Go ahead. Yes, Fraser. Rex Linden here. Yes. What did he say? I see. Well, offer him 25,000. Cash down. As soon as he likes. If he walks straight out of the place just taking his personal things and any sentimental bits and pieces and leaves the rest. Yes. 25,000. All right. Ring me here later.
What about, dear? Some more of your mysterious business?
No, not really. You
Remember me telling you about a nice little country place in Hampshire? Small manor house with about 10 acres and all the comforts?
You're going to buy it?
Lock, stock and barrel.
Oh, but Rex, darling, that'll be wonderful. And, you know, just at the perfect time. Oh, goodness. Oh, I do hope you get it.
I'll lay 10 to 1 I do. And tonight, too. You'll see.
But can you afford to put down £25,000? Just like that?
Oh, yes. And quite a good deal more, Ducky. What? I sound a vulgar type, don't I? Perhaps I am. It is a solemn thought.
But how do you make all this money, Rex? I don't understand. I mean, what do you do? Rene was asking me that the other day.
Oh, live on me wits and gamble with the boys of the city. Kind of racketeer, really. Free of tax, too. deluxe model spiff.
Oh, darling, nobody knows what you're talking about.
I do, and he's right. What about these tea things?
Oh, we'll clear and wash up ourselves. I really can't ask Mrs. Cotton. I wish we could have gone out for dinner tonight, but really, it's hopeless here.
I can't imagine any restaurant.
Oh,
I'll
be eating that.
Oh, Rex, will you see who that is?
Righto.
Good evening.
Good evening. Is Professor Linden in? I'm one of his students.
Oh, yes. Come in, Miss...
Westmore? Oh. Edith Westmore.
You'll have to wait, I'm afraid. My father isn't back yet, though I gather he's expected at any moment.
Yes, I was at his lecture. Well, there's another student, too. We write an essay for him every week.
I know. Explain the 30 Years' War. Do sit down.
Thank you.
Good lecture?
Oh, yes. Wonderful. He makes it all seem so clear and so exciting and... It's hard to take notes. And then afterwards, somehow...
You can't remember a damn thing.
How do you know?
I was a history student once. You're using the wrong shade of lipstick, you know.
Oh. Am I? Yes, I expect I am.
You need a darker shade. Do you mind my talking like this?
No, not really. It's a bit embarrassing, of course, but... You live in London, don't you?
Yes, I'm a West End type now.
Well, I haven't much time to make myself look nice. And no money. I have a scholarship, and you can only just live on it if you don't expect help from home, and I don't. Well, what else is wrong? You seem a bit of an expert.
Oh, I am. Now... Suppose you take off your glasses.
My glasses? Hmm. Oh, all right.
Yeah, and now pull your hair back and then up. No, not quite like that. Further back, then up. Ah, there. That makes a tremendous difference. You'd be surprised. Now, any sensible young man would want to kiss you. I mean, more or less like this. Oh, sir, I didn't mean to...
No, it's not you. I didn't mind that. Oh, it's something quite different. Suddenly I felt so miserable. As if everything's so hopeless. Oh, where's my rotten handkerchief?
Here, take mine.
Oh, thank you.
What's the essay about this week?
Charles the Fifth.
Oh, do you care about Charles the Fifth?
No. Oh, I've tried. And Professor Linden's so kind. I must do well. They're all expecting me to at home. And my essay is so dull and stupid.
I'll tell you a secret about Charles the Fifth if you promise not to mention it to my father.
Oh, all right. What is it?
Charles the Fifth doesn't matter a sausage. I haven't thought about it for years, and I'm having a hell of a good time. That's my advice to you.
Oh, it's different for you. There's no money at home, and I only just managed to get this scholarship.
Stop worrying. Start living. There isn't much time.
Isn't much time for what?
For anything. And none for Charles the Fifth. He had his share, and we'd better take ours while we can.
Oh, Rex!
Hello, Dinah.
I'm so sorry I was wasn't here when you came. Oh, did you bring Jean and Marion?
Yes.
Good. Well, I just had to go to orchestra practice.
And how was it?
Gosh, we were awful. Oh, hello, Miss Westmore.
Hello.
Isn't Daddy back yet? I think he's trying to buy some sherry. It's his birthday today and we're having a sort of family gathering.
Perhaps I'd better go.
Oh, I shouldn't. Not now you're here. Hang on a bit. Oh, how are Jean and Marion?
Inclined to be quarrelsome types. In the car, it was like giving a lift to Thomas Aquinas and Lenin. They're much better apart, those girls.
Oh, I must go and talk to them. I hope you bought Daddy a lovely present. After all, you're the rich one in this family.
I am, and I did. A case of pipes, very special. Took a lot of finding, let me tell you.
Shh, I think he's here. Daddy, they're here.
Ah, how are you, Dad?
Oh, hello, my boy.
Well, I'm sure he won't want to bother with me tonight.
Doesn't that gloomy boy usually come with you on Fridays?
Oh, yes, Bernard Fawcett. I don't know what's happened to him.
Oh, just brooding somewhere, I expect. Well, I must go and see my sisters. I haven't seen them for ages.
Hello, Dinah. Oh. Good rehearsal? How's the cello?
Awful.
I hope you haven't been waiting long, Miss Westmore. Do sit down.
Oh, thank you.
Where's Fawcett?
I don't know, Professor Linden. I haven't seen him this afternoon.
Well, we'll have to do without him. That your paper?
Oh, yes.
Ah, thank you.
Can I say many happy returns?
Oh, you can, and thank you very much. 65, you know. I ought to feel something special, and I've been trying all day and can't manage it. The last time I felt something quite definite was when I was 40, and I've never felt quite so old since. Now then, here, have a look through this portfolio.
Thanks.
You'll find some reproductions of old Peter Bruegel in there. He's a great favourite of mine. Earthly and elfish at the same time. Real life, but with bits of magic starting to work. Look at the winter and the summer.
Yes.
And the peasants boozing and romping.
Mm.
Oh, come in. Ah, good evening, Fawcett.
I'm sorry I'm late. I went to the chemist's, I couldn't get served.
I was late myself. And I'll have to cut you short tonight, I'm afraid. Yes, there's a family reunion here. Let's have your essay and sit down.
I've got it here, sir.
Oh, thank you. Dull, isn't it?
Yeah, I expect it is. When I have a cold, I can't get interested somehow.
Miss Westmore couldn't either. All a long way off, and who cares?
Oh, I'm sorry, Professor Linden.
How do you like those Bruegels? Fascinating, aren't they?
Yes, but I'd like to look at them for a long time.
You can, if you like. Take them away with you.
Oh, thank you.
But the point is, that man was one of Charles V's subjects. And allowing for old Bruegel's temperament, you have to see Charles against that sort of background. Makes a difference, doesn't it?
Why, yes. Do you know, somehow I never thought about that.
Oh, no. You saw it as a lot of dim stuff in a book to be mugged up this week for old Linden. And so did Fawcett, didn't you, Fawcett? With real life roaring all around you. Now, look. This is a ticket to admit two to a meeting. Probably an indignation meeting of the Burmanly Citizens Vigilance Society. To be held tomorrow afternoon in the town hall. Now, I suggest you go together, notebook in hand, to this meeting, and each write an essay for me on the influence of Tudor England upon Burmanly Citizens Vigilance Society.
Tudor England?
Mm.
But how can it? I mean, there won't be any possible connection between Tudor England and this meeting.
Well, if there isn't, then say so. But I think there's sure to be, even without going to the meeting. I can think of several possibly important links.
Well, we could try, anyhow.
Yeah.
Professor Linden, can I ask you something?
Charles V?
No, sir. What do you think's best for colds?
Oh, sorry, Father.
Oh, no, no, come in, Marion. We've finished. Two of my students, Miss Westmore, Mr.
Hello.
Fawcett.
How do you do?
My daughter, Madame de Vaury.
How do you do?
How do you do?
Now, Fawcett, here's the ticket.
Oh, thank you, sir.
And if my subject still doesn't make sense to you, look in sometime after tomorrow afternoon and tell me about it. And keep taking a peep at old Bruegel, Miss Westmore.
Oh, yeah.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Well, now.
Many happy returns, Father.
Oh, thank you, Marion.
And I've bought you a very nice present.
two bottles of very good Armagnac.
Oh, Armagnac! My dear girl, what a wonderful present. I haven't tasted Armagnac for 6 or 7 years at least. Every single sip will be a holiday in France.
It's hard to get, even in France now. But René managed it.
Hmm. You're looking well, Marion. Happily settled there now. The truth, mind, just between us.
Yes. I'm happily settled now.
Oh, good.
It wasn't easy at first. French people of that class are so terribly clannish and close. But the church part of it helped a lot. That and the children. So now I'm one of them.
Hmm. I suppose that's possible, if it's what you want to be. And I remember you always wanted something different. Somewhere around the corner, and, well, this must be it.
Yes. And I feel even better about it now I've come back here. Oh, Dad. It's no use. I must tell you. I hate it here. It's so messy and drab and slovenly. I never liked it. But now it's much, much worse. I hate to think of you being here trying to teach history to dreary, shabby little half-baked students like those two.
They're not my brightest, but they're better than they look. I know something about them, where they come from, how they struggle to get here. The odds against their being any good at all. I can't agree, my dear. This is Burmanley, you know.
Yes, and I never want to see it again. You must come and stay with us from now on, Father.
I'll try, though holidays abroad aren't easy.
But, Daddy, you look so tired and...
Yes, and old. Go on, say it.
Well, you do look much older, Dad. Older than you ought to look. Can I say this, Dad?
You could say anything you like, my dear.
Mother says you have some money coming to you now. From your endowment insurance.
Oh, yes.
You could easily find some official excuse, health or a book or something, to drop everything here and come and live near us at Vaury.
Why should we do that, Marion?
Because it's a much better life than you find here. It's still part of the old civilized tradition, Father. Especially if you can do as I have done and become a Catholic. I can see that Father Honoré was right. That's the secret, the faith. That and the land and... all the old tradition of living.
But, my dear...
I mean it, Father. At first, I did it all for René, of course. But now I know it's worth doing for its own sake. I couldn't live any other way.
Well, that's your affair, Marion, if that's what you want and it satisfies you.
More than that. Makes me deeply happy.
Then that's all right. But you mustn't try to give it to me. Or to most of us. We tried it once. The peasants, the proprietors in their castles, the priests, the whole tradition. And then it didn't work.
Yes, but...
It doesn't work now, except in spots here and there. And those places really depend on other places, like Burmanley, for instance. You're living a very pleasant life, no doubt, my dear, but it can't solve a single major human problem.
It solved mine.
But not mine. Not ours, not the world's.
Father.
Ah, well, Jean.
Hello, Father. Many happy returns. I brought you some books. I left them upstairs.
Thank you, my dear. Now, I spent half an hour this evening acquiring a bottle of what is probably not much better than cooking sherry. I'll go and uncork the muck for us.
How do you think Father is looking?
Not too bad. He's 65, you know.
I suppose he's probably another of the people you think might as well be dead.
Don't invent stupid, insensitive things like that and then put them into my mouth. Though it's rather typical, that trick.
Typical of what?
Of you nice old-fashioned Christian souls. I've often noticed it.
I believe the only explanation, Jean, is that you're jealous of me. Of my peace of mind.
We've got bottles of your peace of mind in the dispensary. We injected into the bad cases.
Oh, shut up.
Make way for the sherry. There we are. You know, what you two ought to do is to take some whacking great wallops at each other. Then you'd feel better.
Don't be cheeky.
All right. But look, don't go and muck up Daddy's birthday between you. And look here, what's the idea of everybody turning up for it this time?
It's to clear up one or two things. About Dad's retiring and so forth.
He won't retire. And it looks like a plot to me. There's a plotty atmosphere about, particularly around Mother. Oh, Marion, Mother said if you really want to add a few fancy French tastings and touches to the dinner, now's the time.
Ah.
And Rex is messing about in the kitchen trying to do something, but I don't know what.
Oh, well, I'll go and see. I can't be worse than Rex.
Dinah, where's Dad?
Try to find the corkscrew. He always loses it.
I want to put through a call to the hospital. If I can get through, will you rush out and hold Dad up for a moment or two?
All right. I bet this isn't hospital work, though, but some man you're miserable about.
Hello, is that Trunks? This is Bermondley 25813, and I want Northern, London, 5484. Yes, I'll wait.
Isn't it?
Yes, it is.
I guessed it. Well, I knew you were miserable anyhow. But look, this is more like Marion than you. I thought you considered this romantic sort of love a lot of silly old-fashioned rot.
I do. That doesn't make it any better, does it?
No. No, I suppose it might make it worse, because you couldn't enjoy being miserable.
And you might despise yourself, too. Is that North Middlesex? Dr. Linden here. Put me through to Dr. Shargrove, please. Go on, Dinah.
Hurry up, please.
Righto. Dr. Shargrove, please. Yes. Oh, Dorothy, this is Jean. Yes, I'm speaking from Bermondley. I must know about Arnold. Has he gone? I see. No message for me at all. Not a word. I see. Just gone. Like that. No, I'm all right. Tomorrow night, I hope. By the way, Dorothy, I forgot to leave a message to Crossfield that he ought to look at that child in 5. Yes, that's the one, and I'm not satisfied. Yes. Yes. Goodbye, Dorothy.
Well, we've a choice of 2 aperitifs. My sherry, which may or may not be any good, and a mysterious concoction that Rex has brought, specially put up for him by one of his favourite barmen. We'd better try it, I suppose. And a curious thing about Rex, he does with complete ease all the things I wouldn't know how to begin to do. All the things I've probably secretly wanted to do all my life. Rex is just busy representing my unconscious self. You too, in a way, Jean. Now then, try this, my dear. And your health, Dr. Linden.
And yours, Professor.
It's got a warm, disreputable flavour.
I've had it before, once or twice.
Oh, you have?
Oh, damn. You know something's wrong, don't you?
Yes. Tell me if you want to.
I can't. I thought you'd guessed I wasn't feeling very bright. Oh, I get so impatient with myself. Why can't we be as hard as steel?
Because it would do us more harm than good. That's asking to be broken. Jean, my dear, just take it easy.
Here are the pipes, Dad, and easily the pick of the market.
Rex, my boy, these are prodigious. Thank you. I didn't know there were such pipes anymore.
There aren't. I had to comb London for them. Collector's pieces, really. Well, Dad.
Come along, both of you.
Cheers for the birthday.
Oh, Mrs. Carton's just
Thank you, my dears.
But we've got time for one of those drinks that we've heard so much about.
Now, there's Dad's sherry or the stuff I brought later than you think.
What do you mean, dear?
Well, that's the name I gave it. The barman couldn't think of one. From the old Chinese saying, enjoy yourself, it's later than you think.
I don't know what you're talking about, darling. But give me just a little, please.
And the sherry for me, Rex.
Oh, me too, please. Oh. Well, now, I call this a thoroughly sensible way for a family to behave.
Oh, you mean all tippling, eh?
I mean being all together under one roof, instead of scattered all over the place. Well, now,
we all drink to Daddy.
Yes, of course.
To the gnarled old trunk of the linden tree.
He's not gnarled. Anyway, what about me?
You're not the trunk, you're the roots.
That's right. Oh, terribly strong, isn't it?
Yes, it always was. Cheers.
Jean, are you all right?
Yes, yes, she's all right. And I thank you for the toast. Both for the terms in which it has been proposed and the way in which you have received it.
Yeah.
Well, I like to see everybody happy for a change. You better go in and eat that dinner, because it's in there now and it's getting cold.
All right, Mrs. Cotton. Come along, everybody.
Come along.
Oh,
yes.
Wait a second.
Well, Rex, being a parent, I have to pretend to understand you, but as a matter of fact, I don't. What do you do? And what are you up to?
It's so simple that hardly anybody believes me. First, what do? Well, I make money by buying stocks and shares and then selling them at a handsome profit. All for myself, not for other people. I'm not a broker.
You must have some kind of flair for it.
Oh, I have. But it's easy, believe me. You work 10 times as hard as I do, and now I'm worth, well, what do you think?
I've no idea.
At least 150,000 at this minute.
Good God. But it's incredible. How have you managed it in this short time?
Jock Mitchell was killed by the same mortar that knocked me out in Italy. He was my best friend. When I came home, I found he'd left me all he had. I came in for a nice little packet of stocks and shares that poor Jock hadn't bothered about. After I recovered and was sent to the war house, I began playing about with him. Made money, made more money, got in the know. Paid no taxes, don't forget. Every time some bit of news made the fools in the city feel shaky, I bought. The minute they felt better again, I sold.
Couldn't be as easy as that.
It was. As to what I'm up to, that's quite simple too. I'm enjoying myself while there's time.
You don't see it lasting, I mean?
I don't see anything lasting. If you ask me, we've had it. We can't last. And anyhow, when the atom bombs and rockets really start falling, whichever side sends them, it's about 10 to 1 we'll be on the receiving end here. Oh, I sometimes thought about clearing out. Somehow, I feel that wouldn't do. So I'll take what's coming. But before then, I propose to enjoy myself.
I believe you're quite serious.
I'm not a serious type, as a rule. Do a lot of clowning. But for once, and purely out of respect for you in this occasion, I'm in deadly earnest. What about some of Marion's Armagnac?
Hmm? Oh, sorry, I'd forgotten. All this, of course, is a reaction. First from what you were before the war, and then from soldiering. The usual dose of post-war cynicism.
Thanks. No doubt, but it's not a mood. It's permanent.
Doesn't it occur to you that if we are drifting to disaster, you might try using some of your money and wits and energy in some kind of attempt to stop it?
The other night, I was reading some of Whaley's translations of old Chinese poems, and one of them particularly took my fancy. It's called The Big Chariot. Don't help on the big chariot. You will only make yourself dusty. Don't think about the sorrows of the world. You will only make yourself wretched. And I couldn't agree with him more. Oh, don't look so depressed, Dad.
I'm not depressed. I'm wondering. You've changed completely. What happened? That interests me.
First losing Jock. And some of the other chaps. Then that spell at the war house. And wartime London. But even then I was still ready to put my shoulder to one of the back wheels of the big chariot and be as dusty as hell if somebody big enough had shouted, "Come on, chaps, throw in everything you've got. Either we'll work miracles or go down fighting."
I see. You were ready if somebody gave you a lift.
Yeah. But not a sausage. So I said to myself, "All right, Rex, you pack it up. Earn some money and play." And I do enjoy myself. Oh, you can't in Burmanley, but you can where I live. If you know a few chaps and have the money.
There'll be some coffee in a minute.
Oh, Jean.
Have some brandy, Jean.
Not just now, thank you. Rex telling you how to make money without working for it?
No, he's been explaining why he believes in making money without working for it. Hey, Rex?
Fair enough. Mine's the Spiff philosophy now. Only mugs work. It's everybody for himself, isn't it? Oh, look at Jean. I run into her now and again. With her boyfriend. And they try to convert me. What's his name? I mean the surgeon chap at your place.
Arnold French. He's just left, by the way.
Has he now?
Why, I thought you and he...
Convert you to what?
Well, tell him.
Doesn't matter. I don't want to talk about it. We... I happen to believe in science and a properly planned community. And discipline and work and...
Enforced labour camps for anybody who won't join in.
Yes, and why not? I've no use for people who won't face a few hard facts.
You haven't much use for people of any kind, my dear Jean. Except a few interesting patients and your handsome Arnold.
Oh, for God's sake, shut up, you fool!
Look, Jeannie, I'm sorry, I didn't
realize... Oh, drop it! I'm just not going to run away and bawl in a bedroom.
Well, there's probably something to be said for it, though. An old custom.
And what's the use of asking for a disciplined scientific society if I can't even discipline myself?
You're still one of us, you know. The same old muddled and emotional gang who've been here for a few hundred thousand years. Don't try to fight all your feminine ancestors. There are too many of them. Much better come to terms with them.
And have some Armagnac now. Do you good.
All right, Rex. I'm sorry for the outburst.
We have a new vice-chancellor here. Dr. Lidley.
Hello. What's he like? Yeah.
Thanks.
He's an educationalist. He educationalizes in quite a big, dashing sort of way. It's something quite different from educating people. Newer and much better. They'll probably have machines to do it soon, when they can import them from America. Two of my oldest friends here, Tilly and Clark, have already resigned. I believe he's hoping that I'll go next. I won't say I see it in his eye, because he always gives the extraordinary impression that he has two glass eyes, which must be wrong, and there it is. Fortunately, you two haven't that kind of eye. Far more expressive. But what exactly did those glances mean?
We were wondering, at least I know I was, why you should think it's worthwhile going on here.
Right. Why not pack it up now?
We can't all pack it up, as you call it, Rex. And one packed-up man in a family is probably quite enough.
Ouch.
As for you, Jean, who are not a packer-up, well, I'm surprised at you.
You are 65 now, Dad.
Yes, and one day, Jean, I hope you'll be 65. Then you may know what I'm feeling now.
Dad, please, I didn't mean...
Oh, I know you didn't. Nobody does. Mind you, I'll say this. 65 is probably oldish for science. But history's different. You really do know more about it and have the feel of it better when you're 65 than when you're 45. Mm. Or even 25. coffee, Dinah.
Coffee it is. And I made it myself while the others were finishing the washing up. You've been quarrelling here, haven't you?
No, we haven't. Coffee, Dad.
Oh, thank you.
Well, that's what it feels like to me.
Yes.
Sugar? It's quite dark. Even if you dare to complain, they don't hesitate to be rude at once.
I didn't say it's much better in the French cities. But in the country, there's still a tradition of taking trouble and service and politeness.
Well, it's quite hopeless in England. Now, children, as we're all here, I think we ought to talk about the money.
What money, my dear?
The endowment insurance. It was your idea, but Rex knows all about it, and perhaps it would be better if he explained it to the others.
Well, for years and years, ever since we were in the nursery, in fact, Dad's been paying premiums on an endowment insurance. Now that he's 65, the money's due to arrive at any moment. Mm. And the parents agreed that this was really a family insurance, for all of us to have some share if we needed it. That's partly why we're here.
But we're quite glad to see you, even as shareholders.
Now, Robert, this is serious.
It's serious that you should feel like this. We appreciate it. But really, it's all nonsense, you know. This money's all yours. We don't want
any
part of it.
We realise that you don't, my boy, but there are others.
Well, let's see. What do you say, girls?
You can count me out. Dad spent a lot on my education. The least I can do is say I don't need any more money. And, of course, I don't.
Neither do I. Rennie and I are much better off than you and Mother are. Hmm.
And... I could probably manage somehow.
Oh, don't be absurd, Dinah. We're not really talking to you.
Well, I don't see why not. A girl I know...
Your offer is noted, Miss Linden, but not accepted. Oh, we shall be responsible for you for a few years yet, whether you like it or not. Now, are you three quite sure?
Well, of course.
Well, yes, you of course, Rex, but you two girls.
Of course we are. These are your savings, almost all you have. And you're 65.
And still in full possession of my faculties. And still Professor of Modern History in the University of Bermondsey.
Yes, but for how much longer?
Until I decide to resign the chair.
I'll answer it.
Castle in Spain.
Oh, at the very least, I should think.
Hello.
What?
Rex again, I
think. Oh, yes, he is. Just a sec. It's for you, Rex. You're right. From London.
This will be Fraser, about the place in Hampshire. You'll see.
Oh.
Thank you, Dinah.
Dealing the dealing.
Yes? Rex Linden here. Ah, I thought he would. Now, probably tomorrow night. Oh, on Monday, if he likes. Oh, yes, yes, I'll do all that. Nice job, Fraser. Bye.
Rex, you bought it?
I have. Oh. Behold the new owner and lord of the manor of Four Elms, Childing, Hants.
Oh,
47, 10 bed, 4 bath, billiard room, sun porch, art tennis court, croquet lawn, large garden, 10 acres, small dairy, and butter for tea. You're all invited.
Oh, gosh, that's marvellous.
But you have to put some furniture and stuff into it.
Oh, no, everything's there, isn't it, Rex?
How wonderful.
Yes, ready to walk into. Even a man and wife on the premises.
Oh, you sound so grand. I can't believe you lived here.
This one didn't. It's another Rex who lived here.
Don't be silly. Rex has done well, and I'm proud of him. Now, listen, darling. This settles it, you know.
Yes, I think it does.
Hmm? Settles what?
Shall we tell him? No. We'll wait a little while.
There's plotting. I knew there was.
Well, I don't much like plotting, and I don't much like the sound of this.
Oh, dear.
That may be for me.
Well, it won't be if you answer it. Somehow it never is.
It's true, isn't it?
It is true. Yes.
Oh, yes, she is. It's for you, Mother.
Oh,
thank you. Thank you, Mr. Lockhart.
Lockhart? Oh, that'll be for me.
He said Mrs. Linden quite distinctly.
Yes?
Oh, well, if that's the case.
Yes, Mr. Lockhart. Yes, I see. You're certain.
Don't let him go.
What? No. Sorry, I'm speaking to my husband.
I want to speak to him.
Now, Robert.
When you've finished, Isabel.
He wants to speak to you.
Thank you. Alfred, I don't want to know what you've been talking about to my wife. That's your business. But I'm wondering if you've anything you'd like me to know. Never mind being delicate about it, Alfred. We've known each other far too long for that.
Do you want some more tea, dear?
Sure.
Yes, I've just had some.
No.
No, I know that. But I don't propose to accept this, you know.
No,
not for a moment. I'll see you in the morning. And I warn you, the fight's on. Isabel, I don't like the way that was done. Alfred Lockhart didn't sound too happy about it either. Had you been speaking to him earlier?
Now, there's no need to look and talk like that, Robert. I did have a word with him because I wanted to know what might happen.
Why?
Oh, really, Robert, there's no need at all to take that tone. I just wanted to know, if possible, while the children were here, so that if any arrangements had to be made...
The only arrangements that have to be made are quite simple. I am going to fight this decision by every possible means in my power.
Oh, but why? Why? We needn't live in a London flat. We can stay in Rex's country house until we can find a little place of our own.
Yes.
Dinah can stay in Birmingham until the end of the summer term.
No. There's work to be done here, and I am still capable of doing it.
Dad.
I have just been told that I shall be asked to resign my chair. Officially, because I've reached the official age limit. But really, it's because I'm a nuisance. I'm too free and easy. I don't admire the mass production and conveyor belt system of education. I say no when important personages expect to hear yes. And I propose to go on being a nuisance.
But Dad, it simply isn't worth it. And if they don't want you, all right, what does it matter? You've done your share.
Of course he has more than his share, hanging on for years in this miserable place.
Don't talk as if I were choosing a holiday resort. It's my life we're discussing. Or rather, we're not discussing. Let's drop the subject. I don't want to lose my temper. Besides, after all, it is my birthday.
Yes, it is. And I think we ought to play Black Sam. We haven't played it for years. And this family always used to play Black Sam on all holidays and special occasions.
Have you still got the cards and counters?
Well, they're about somewhere, but where? I can't imagine.
Do you remember that time up in Cumberland when the farmer came in from next door and we made him play Black Sam with us?
Yes.
He was left with Black Sam every time.
And he was so furious. Do you remember, Jean?
Yes. What was it he used to say?
Well, lay me out and bury me. I've got a dumb thing again.
Yes, and then something happened to his collar.
Oh, yes, the stud went.
And he said, sit down, there's Black Sam me clean out of me collar.
Oh, poor man.
What's the matter, my dear?
I suddenly felt awful, hearing you all laughing again. and remembering what fun we used to have. Oh, I went back long before that holiday in Cumberland, to when you were all very little. And before that, when everything was beginning for us. I don't know what you tell those students of yours, Robert, but I'd like to tell them something. The truth, for once. The real truth.
And what's that, Isabel?
That everything just gets worse and worse. And it's time we stop pretending it doesn't. When we were young, up to 1914, the world was sensible and safe and kind. And even if people didn't have much money, they had most of the things they wanted. They could be happy in a simple, easy way, because life seemed good. And afterwards, after those years of great black casualty lists every day, oh, it was never the same again. Never the same. But it wasn't too bad. We still didn't know all the horrors and cruelties and miseries. You could go away for real holidays. But then everything got worse and worse. Look at us now. Just look at us. With only a few years more and all the colour and fun and life gone forever. I tell you, it's heartbreaking.
Oh, Mother, you're not fair. It's just because you're not interested, so you make it all seem dull and grey to yourself. Oh, it's all terribly exciting, really. And sometimes I lay awake at night and think and wonder and can hardly bear it.
No, Dinah, you don't understand what I'm talking about. You're too young. You're much too young.
Yes. She's too young to understand what you feel. But she's given you the answer just because she is young. Some things are worse, some things are better. And the sun will shine for Dinah tomorrow, my love, as it once shone for you 40 years ago. The same sun. And young families are still laughing somewhere at old farmers who burst their collars. And while there's time to lose the world, Rex, there's also time to save it, if we really want to save it. And there's also time, and of course, it might be the last, you never know, for the Linden family game of Black Sam.
Yes.
Well, give us our counters, Rex. Oh, that's your job.
Oh, right.
While the old man with his patience shuffles the cards. Patience, patience. And shuffle the cards.
How'd you make that out, eh? Just tell me that. How'd you make that out?
It's your business to make it our Bernard, as you call it, not ours.
Oh.
Isn't it, Madame de Saint-Vaury?
Of course it is.
They think they can come along with any piffling little argument against religion and that we have to reply when the best minds of the last 2,000 years have been...
What people want is a properly planned and controlled world.
How can you plan and control without any real authority to guide you? That's where the church comes
You're
in.
You're talking out-of-date metaphysics. You don't even know it. That's your trouble.
Oh, you ladies who are in the dining room. Packed up to go, then?
Yes, at least I have.
So have I.
Well, what about getting on with brains trust here? What's the subject?
It's a good old favourite. Science versus religion.
Oh, never fancied either of them, really. Had a sister that weren't religious, chapel, and an uncle that was a bit on the scientific side. Insects, chiefly.
Well, we're not really debating chapels versus insects.
Helping Mother Pack is no joke. Mrs. Cotton, do you know anything about a little travelling clock?
No, I don't.
Neither do I.
Oh, I believe it's in my room. Shall I go?
No, I'm going up.
But in a way, it is chapels versus insects. I mean, Bernard and Dr. Linden talk as if we were only a superior sort of insect.
No, we don't. The point is, if we study insect life, we know exactly what we're doing.
Yeah. And we know what we're doing in chapels and churches. Oh.
We're behaving like spiritual beings.
Or like superstitious savages.
Do savages have chapels and churches?
It's just savages who don't. And now they're turning themselves into savages again.
On the contrary, we're using our reason and knowledge of scientific method to try and...
To blow everything and everybody to bits.
Yes. That's right.
Chiefly encouraged by your precious church.
That's simply not true.
Yes, of course it is.
No, it is not.
Oh, you can't reason with them. They won't listen
to it. Go on our side. Chapels versus insects.
Oh,
oh dear.
Listen to Dinah.
What is that?
First movement of the Elgar Concerto.
Sounds a sad piece.
Yes, it is. A kind of long farewell. An elderly man remembers his world before the war of 1914. some of it years and years before, perhaps. Being a boy at Worcester, or Germany in the 90s. Long days on the Malvern Hills, smiling Edwardian afternoons. McLaren and Ranji batting at Lord's. Then Richter or Nickish at Queen's Hall. All gone, gone. Lost forever. And so he distills his tenderness and regrets, drop by drop, and seals the sweet melancholy in a concerto for cello. And he goes too, where all the old green sunny days and the twinkling nights went. Gone, gone. But then what happens? Why, a little miracle. You heard it.
Dinah playing?
Why, yes. Young Dinah Linden. All youth, all eagerness, saying hello and not farewell to anything. Who knows and cares nothing about Bavaria in the 90s or the secure and golden Edwardian afternoons. Here in Bermondley this very afternoon, the moment we stop shouting at each other, unseals for us the precious distillation, uncovers the tenderness and regret, which are ours now as well as his, and our lives and Elgar's, Bermondley today and the Malvern Hills in a lost sunlight, are all magically intertwined.
Oh, when he likes, the Professor's a lovely talker.
Well, that settles me. Now, what are you two doing here? What about that meeting?
We came to tell you it's been cancelled.
So, as we had no other subject for this week's essay, we thought we'd better tell you at once.
I see.
What about tea, Mrs. Cotton? Oh, I'll come and help.
Oh, come on, then.
You're probably both going to the Union show tonight, aren't you?
Yes. Yeah.
Would it be a nuisance for you to slip in here afterwards?
Oh, no.
Of course not, no.
Oh, then do that, please. So, off you go. And I'm sorry you had to wait.
Oh, that's all right. Dr. Linden?
Yes?
I hope I didn't sound rude when we were all arguing. Oh. Bernard always makes me lose my temper when he attacks religion.
No, no, I didn't mind.
High time you lost your temper, Miss Westmore. Pity I missed that. I lost my temper this morning, up at the university offices. Well, perhaps I shall see you tonight.
All right.
Goodbye.
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 Did you lose your temper this morning?
I did. I raised merry hell. I told them they couldn't get rid of me simply by remembering we're supposed to have an age limit.
So you think it's all over and done with?
Why, don't you?
No, I don't.
Yes, well, I ought to write a letter or two.
They can wait a minute, Dad. And we're alone. Nobody listening. You can tell me. I'm not one of the get-him-out-of-here party.
Who is, or are, members of it?
Mother, Rex, Marion. Now confess, Dad. It's not all as easy as you pretend, is it?
No, it isn't. Between ourselves, of course. Nevertheless, I'll settle it all right. Actually, the battle's not over. Maybe going on now. Lidley probably imagines from my grumpy manner that I haven't any friends round here. Well, he's wrong. I still have a few. I shall start a campaign. These notes are part of the campaign. Otherwise, I shouldn't bother about them now. Yes?
Nothing.
Feeling miserable, aren't you?
And hating myself.
Now, that's the trouble. You resent your own emotions. You're annoyed with yourself for being a woman. It's quite wrong. After all, there's no escape from it. This man you're in love with, perhaps he isn't worth it. And you'll have to get over him. Buy a bottle of gin. Sit up with a girlfriend and have a damn good cry and then start again on a better basis. Don't demand a world as efficient, sterilised and scientific as an operating theatre. We couldn't live in it if we got it. Don't confuse science with life. It's an abstraction. Neat and quick to get certain things done.
We should have a long talk.
Yes. Come up here alone as soon as you can, eh?
Dad, I think I ought to warn you. Mother's more serious than you think.
She needs a change badly, of course. Bermondley's been a bit too much for her lately, I know. Don't blame her.
It's gone further than you think.
Believe that, do you?
Tea's in.
I'm coming, Marion.
Don't be long, Father.
Early, isn't it?
Yes, but we should be starting soon. But Mother said you needn't bother. She's having hers now. And she said she wanted to talk to you.
I hated that noisy argument we had this afternoon.
You made a hell of a row about it.
What's the matter with everybody here?
Oh, all kinds of things.
No, I mean, why are you all so completely materialistic now? As if nothing on earth mattered but production and exports and what people earned.
Remember the miracle of the loaves and fishes?
Yes, of course.
Materialistic?
No, that's quite different.
The idea is the same. Spread it out and give everybody a fair share. It's never been done before, you know. Not in a whole large society. Oh, there's been colour, grace, culture, philosophy, noble spiritual lives, but always with a lot of poor devils, whole masses of people left clean out, slogging away in the dark, ignored, forgotten. Is it materialistic and sordid not to ignore and forget them? To bring them all out into the light to take their share?
Yes, but to talk and think about nothing else.
Wrong, yes. I keep saying so. But give us a chance, my dear Marion. Call us drab and dismal if you like, but for heaven's sake, recognise that we're trying to do something that is as extraordinary and wonderful as it is difficult. To have a revolution for once without the terror, without setting in motion that vast pendulum of violence which can decimate 3 generations before it comes to a standstill. We're fighting in the last ditch of our civilization. If we win through, everybody wins through.
Oh, there you are, Marion. Do go and finish your tea. Rex wants to start in half an hour.
All right, Mother. Don't fuss. I'm quite ready.
Did you hear anything more this afternoon, Robert?
No, my love. I have an idea that Lidley's busy with my protest at this very moment. Alfred Lockhart told me there might be some sort of meeting this evening. So I might have more news later tonight.
You know what I think about it. And Rex and Marion and even Jean, I think, agree with me.
Well, they could be wrong, too. I don't enjoy not having you on my side in this, you know, Isabel.
And you think I enjoy it? I hate it. I hate it. But they never really liked you here, and that's what you've never understood. It was never your place. I knew it, and you ought to have known it. And all this is just another reason why I am glad to go.
You've had a particularly difficult time lately, I know, my dear. A change will do you good. Rex will see that you enjoy yourself. I'm glad you're going. When you come back, my little quarrel with Lidley and his set will be over, I hope. And we'll try to find some more help for you in the house.
I'm not coming back.
You don't mean that.
Robert, I mean every word of it. I'm not coming back. I'm leaving Bermondley forever.
Never mind Bermondley. You're leaving me.
No, I'm not leaving you. That's the point.
Oh, I don't see it.
But it's quite simple, Robert. You ought to retire. You've been told to. There's nothing to keep us here. We can live with Rex for a while, and afterwards, if necessary, we can find a little place of our own. Everybody agrees that this is what we ought to do. It's perfectly obvious, but suddenly you've decided to be obstinate. You want to stay on here, but what about me? Have you ever thought about me?
I've tried to, Isabel. And I realise it's not easy for you.
I never liked Bermondley from the first, but of course I put up with it for your sake. I'd always hoped that we would be able to go somewhere else, and I've always been longing and praying for this time to come, when you'd have to retire, when we'd done with Bermondley forever. Oh, Rex knew what I felt. He's always understood.
Rex the tempter. That's a part that suits him. Offering you breakfast in bed at Huntingdon House. Then Bond Street. Nice little lunch somewhere. A theatre. A little bridge.
All right, and why not? If he offers me those things, yes, and having my hair done properly and looking at silly illustrated weeklies and having a good woman's gossip and sometimes spending money foolishly and being nicely looked after.
Is that what you've always really wanted?
No, it isn't, except somewhere at the back of my mind, like most women. What I've wanted is what I've had, looking after you and the children. Keeping this house going and trying to plan good holidays for us all. And when it had to be done, I did it. I did it gladly, but it hasn't to be done anymore. And I don't want to spend another day in this hateful place.
Hateful? Hateful? But it's just a city full of people working, trying to get along. Not very different from us. Hateful?
Oh, I don't mean I've never been happy here. It was different at first, but
It's hateful now. Grey, dismal, with a stupid, shabby sort of life. It's all meaningless to me. Oh, sometimes I've felt like a wretched ghost. Rex is right. The only thing to do is to laugh at it and then forget it.
My dear, I'm sorry you feel like this. I know it's been hard.
No, Robert, no, please. Just let me say what I want to say. I'll be quite calm. No, I'm not leaving you. I'm leaving Bermondsey. And I'm doing it for your sake as well as for my own. I've tried to persuade you, so have the children. And now I'm doing the only thing that I think may make you behave sensibly. I'm going, and I'm not coming back. If you stay here, Robert, you'll stay here alone, and I don't think you'll want to do that very long, thank goodness. Oh, Robert, please, this isn't a quarrel. I'm not leaving you.
I think you are. A man stays where his work is, and the woman stays with the man.
I did it for 37 years, but you're no longer a man who has his work.
That's the most damnable, hurting thing you've ever said to me.
Oh, I'm sorry, Robert. Oh, I didn't say it to hurt you, but it's true, and you're hurting yourself because you won't admit it.
Sorry to barge in, but I'd like to get off in about 10 minutes. I put most of the stuff in the car. You want to be alone?
No, it doesn't matter now. Come in, darling.
But I didn't know you were going so soon.
In a few minutes.
Oh, gosh, I don't really know what's happening about this family.
Has anybody seen my little red bag?
Well, I'll have a look for it.
Dad, I hope Mother would have persuaded you to come with us.
Well, she hasn't, Marion. She tells me she's leaving Bermondsey for good.
I know. And I think she's right. There's nothing for her here.
Except me. And some work still to be done. I don't think this is simply personal vanity, an elderly man not wanting to be put on the shelf. After all we've heard during the past 24 hours, we know by this time that Bermondsey's a gloomy, shabby hole that nobody but an old fool would want to do any work in. And why work anyway? That's been the line, and it doesn't appeal to me. There's death in it somewhere. Down these fancy side turnings, there are dead ends. I don't want to walk away from real life, give it up as a bad job. I prefer to stay with it and help a bit if I can.
I don't see what this has got to do with anything we've said.
And neither do I.
I say, Mrs. Cotton's furious because she says somebody's taken her tin of soap flakes. Isn't she, Jean?
Well, I must post these letters.
Oh, I'll take them.
No, thanks, Dinah. I'm letting off steam. Better finish it off outside.
Dinah, darling, how would you like to come to London? We could probably arrange for you to go to the Royal College or the Academy of Music.
Oh, and concerts. Mm. Wow. Well, of course, that would be marvellous. But what's happening? I mean, are we all going now? I haven't packed or anything.
No, we're not. Dad isn't going, is he, Mother?
No, he's not. Your father's staying here, Dinah, at least for the time being. Though, in my opinion, he won't be here very long, even if the university doesn't insist on his resignation, and I think they will, although he pretends they won't.
Then I shall stay too. Well, Daddy couldn't be here all by himself. Besides, I like it here, really. Look, what's been happening? Have you been saying things to him?
No, he's been saying things to us.
Mother, what's all this about?
About Dad staying on here. Jean, I'll put your case in the car.
Thanks. Dinah, if a telephone call comes for me, will you say I'm on my way back?
All right.
Rex says you ought to be off.
We're coming now.
Well, go along, and I'll be out in a minute.
Oh, dear.
What's the matter?
I don't know, but I feel rather sad now.
Will you be in tonight, Robert?
Yes, unless there are dramatic developments over at the university.
You're too optimistic about this business.
Why do you say that?
I have a feeling they want to get rid of you, and that they will. So don't expect too much. I'll ring you up from Rex's flat.
Good, good.
But I meant every word I said, Robert. I'm not coming back. It's for your sake as much as mine, and this time you will have to give in. Oh, Robert, I hate this.
And so do I, Isabel. It's all wrong. You think I'm making a mistake, and I think you are. Don't let's have a quarrel out of it, not after all these years. You're my wife. I love you very dearly.
Oh, Robert,
Yes, my dear.
Come on, Mother, we're all set. The roads are calling.
I'm coming, darling. I'll ring you tonight, Robert.
Yes, Mrs. Cotton. Who? Dr. Linden? No, she isn't. She's just gone. I don't know and I don't care. I sound bad-tempered because I am bad-tempered.
Oh, Mrs. Cotton, somebody at the door.
All right, I'm going.
Yes, that's right.
Student.
Good evening.
Oh, good evening.
Professor Linden told us to call here tonight after the union show.
Oh, he's out, but he'll be back any minute. Do sit down.
Thank you.
Oh, where's what's his name?
Bernard Fawcett?
Yes.
Oh, he'll be coming along. I didn't wait for him. He isn't a friend of mine. I don't like him much.
Oh, I don't know him, really. But he always looks as though something or somebody has just upset him.
Usually they have. Is your brother still staying here?
Oh, no. You know, he drove back to London this afternoon. Did you meet him?
Just for a minute or two yesterday. He's very attractive, isn't he?
Oh, I don't know, really. Yes, I suppose he is.
Do you think this lipstick suits me?
I don't know. I'm not good on lipstick. No, much too dark.
Oh, dear.
Another student.
Hello.
Hello. Father will be back any minute. Won't you take off your overcoat?
No, thanks.
Oh, what's the matter?
Oh, these damn colds I get. Headaches, and I can't taste anything properly. Miss Linden, what's this about your father?
What about him?
I told another bloke who's taking history, a chap called Thring. I was coming on here to get next week's essay subject, and he said I needn't bother. Because he told me there's a strong rumour going round that your father's retiring. Right off.
Well, it isn't true.
Very strong rumour, he said. Prof Linden's had it, he said.
Oh, for goodness sake, shut up.
Why should I? Oh, blast.
And I hope it's flu. And the kind that gives you awful pains in your inside. And they make you have castor oil.
Did she say she hoped it was flu?
Yes. She was furious because you said that about her father. Huh? Prof Linden's had it. What a way to talk and what a thing to say to her.
Look, now what have I done? I meet a bloke called Thring.
And I hope he has gastric flu too.
Oh, ribbon. Oh, how I admire your wonderful, delicate sense of humour, Miss Westmore.
If you could only see yourself.
I don't want to see myself.
Well, Fawcett, if you don't want to see yourself, there's no reason why you should until you shave tomorrow morning.
Professor.
Good evening, Miss Westmore.
Good evening.
I apologise once again for keeping you waiting.
Oh, that's all right, Professor Linden.
Thank you. Well, this afternoon's meeting was postponed, eh? And so, much to your relief, I imagine, I'll have to find another subject for next week's essay.
Yes.
Professor Linden?
Yes?
We shall be coming to you next week. I mean...
I hope so. Why not? Oh, really, this is too bad. So you've heard rumours that I may not be here next week, eh?
Yes. Only just tonight at the union.
Well, you oughtn't to have done. But it only proves what I've said before, that a university is a mad village. You two are pretty average Burmanly history students, and here's a question I'd like to put to you to be answered quite truthfully. Would it really matter to you if I wasn't here next week?
Oh, dear.
A truthful, impersonal answer, mind. Fawcett?
No, sir, it wouldn't. Not really. I get on all right with Mr. Pearce and Mr. Saxon. I didn't mean...
Never mind about what you don't mean. You gave me an honest answer. Now, Miss Westmore.
Oh, dearie, it's so difficult.
I could take that as an answer, if necessary.
No. Well, I mean, I enjoy your lectures more than anybody else's. And coming here for the essays. I don't always understand you, as I do Mr. Pierce, but... Well, of course, it would matter terribly if you went.
No, it wouldn't. You're giving me the same answer.
Oh, but I didn't...
No, please, Miss Westmore. Well, that's that. But because we don't know what's going to happen, that's no reason for not doing a bit of work, is it? So let's get back to the 16th century. The 16th century. Yes, well, Shakespeare's at the Globe Theatre writing imperishable masterpieces, and so suppose you try to trace the connection between that glorious fact and the rise of the Lombard cities and the development of the banking system.
The banking system?
Yes, you go back a century, of course. Twelfth Night, Hamlet, here, and there, the Italian cities and the banking system. Letters of credit and loans at 5% at one end of the chain, and at the other, a crowded wooden theatre near the Thames, and the afternoon fading, and a player with a whitened face murmuring, "Absentee from felicity a while." That's all.
And if you're not here?
I've not been told yet that I shan't be, Fawcett. In fact, you may take it that I will be. Excuse me.
Idiot!
What for?
Oh, shut up.
Yes, this is Professor Linden speaking. All right. Look, this is a call from London. It may take some time, so would you mind letting yourselves out? And we meet here, I hope, next Friday at the usual time.
Yes. Good night, Professor Linden.
Good night.
Good night. Yes, Isabel, Robert here. Good. No news at all, but rumours are flying round, of course. No, not worth talking about. Oh, do I? Well, you never did like my telephone voice, did you, my dear? And I may be rather tired. Mrs. Carton? Yes, I'll give her a shout. Just a minute. Mrs. Carton? Mrs. Carton?
Yes?
Hurry! Telephone! I've called her. No, don't worry about us. Regarded from the splendours of Rex's flat, we probably seem worse off than we really are. Well, certainly. Why shouldn't you enjoy it, my dear? I'm glad. Well, I was never good at sounding glad on a long-distance telephone late on Saturday night. Let's leave it at that, then, my dear. Here's Mrs. Cotton. Here you are.
Oh, you. This is Mrs. Cotton. Yes, Mrs. Linden. Well, you said that this morning. Oh, we'll manage. I'll tell them first thing Monday. What? Oh, a bit pinched, I'd say. As if it was a colder night than it is, if you see what I mean. Oh, yeah, she's all right. I tell you, we'll manage. Tomorrow night, same time. Now I'll tell him. Bye. She's going to ring you same time tomorrow night. Money no object. Oh, Mr. X, I suppose. Oh, all this talking on telephones. Where's it got you?
I don't know. I'm not good at it.
Oh, there's a message for you.
Oh, yes?
That Mr. Lockhart, he's coming to see you tonight. Might be any time now.
I see. Well, Alfred Lockhart's an old friend of mine. And, Mrs. Cotton, how much whiskey is there left?
Not much. Might be a couple of pub doubles. Soon goes.
You couldn't by any chance have had any lately, could you?
Oh, just a nip. Yesterday morning, when that ceiling come down, just had to have a nip.
Yes, fair enough. I'd have done the same.
You and me, Professor. We can get on all right. Live and let live, that's our motto.
Something like that. Well, bring what's left of the whiskey and a couple of glasses for Mr. Lockhart and me. We've a ceiling coming down, too.
Right.
Hear that? Music. She's at it. Dinah talked to me in here about housekeeping and shopping and all that. Wants to look after you properly, she does. Bless her.
You must look after her, Mrs. Cotton. I know you're fond of her.
As if she was me own. That Dinah, Professor. She still lives in the land of childhood where you and me's forgotten.
My dear Mrs. Cotton, it's true, of course, but what an extraordinary thing for you to say.
Heard a chap say it on top of a tram, one Easter Monday, and it stuck in me mind. Crossing the river we was, and it was raining a bit and sun shining all at the same time, you know, way it does about Easter.
Mm-hmm.
And everything suddenly so bright and shiny, I could have laughed and cried. And when I heard him say that, it stuck in my mind, you know.
Yes. And perhaps, after all, we're not forgotten.
Here, I'll get you that whiskey, Professor.
Can you hear it properly? That's Casals. Well, you didn't think it was me, did you?
I wondered, but I couldn't think how you'd got the BBC Symphony Orchestra into the dining room.
Oh, wouldn't it be marvellous if you could? Just pack them up in a magic little box.
They're in one now.
Yes. And I'll never be able to play it. Not for ages and ages, if ever. Oh, listen. You see, he's remembering the earlier themes now, Daddy. And he's saying goodbye to them.
Wandering through the darkening house of life. Touching all the things he's loved. Crying farewell. Forever. Forever.
Oh! Oh, bother. I'll go.
If it's anybody but Alfred Lockhart, I can't see them.
Good evening, Dinah. Is your father in?
Oh, it is you, Alfred.
Yes.
Come in.
Yes, sir.
Ah, Dinah, when you've finished with the gramophone, you'd better go to bed.
All right, but I'm a bit excited.
Well, Alfred, you're wearing your undertaker's look tonight. Won't you take your coat off?
No, thank you, Robert. I mustn't stay long.
Well, there's the whiskey. What's left of it. So make the most of it, I say.
Thank you, Mrs. Cotton. And there won't be anything else tonight, so good night.
Good night, Professor.
Well, sit down, Alfred.
Oh, thank you.
Little whiskey?
I'd rather get the official part of my visit over first, if you don't mind, Robert.
I thought there must be an official part. Go ahead.
I have been instructed by the Vice-Chancellor that in the circumstances he will not press for your immediate resignation, though he deplores, and he particularly asked me to tell you this, the attitude you have adopted and trusts you will reconsider your decision.
Alfred, I can't listen to any more of this jargon or watch you pretending to be a civil service dummy. Now, what have they agreed to? Do I stay as I am?
No.
What?
It's a compromise. You give up the chair and most of the work, but you can stay on an emeritus level. No examining, off the Board of Studies. About half salary, a little more, perhaps.
God, Alfred, it's an insult!
It's what I expected.
We'll have that whiskey now, I think. And don't keep on being official, Alfred.
Oh, thank you.
You and I have known each other for over 20 years, skirmished and fought together. And tied up each other's wounds, eh?
Yes. And I'm not being official any longer. To hell with them. And I'm sick of this job. I'll find a way out. And soon, too. Oh, thanks, Robert. Can you spare it?
No. And neither can my housekeeper.
It'll taste all the better. Skål.
Salut.
I'll say what I tried to tell you this morning. You shouldn't have given them this chance. You should have walked out. Your wife was right.
You behave badly there, Alfred, lending yourself to female intrigue. Oh, Isabel, by the way, has gone to live with Rex. Says she's never coming back here.
Bad in theory, but right and sensible in practice. Trying to force your hand. You ought to join her on Monday. Tell the VC he can keep his emeritus nonsense.
I'd enjoy taking him a message in your best style, Robert.
Yes. I'd two students here tonight, Alfred.
Huh?
Average types. Fawcett and the Westmore girl. Huh? So, like a fool, I did a Gallup poll on them. Would it really matter to them if I did go? I gathered it wouldn't. So far as they're concerned, I might as well be in Rex's super flat tonight, swigging his excellent black market whiskey. But insult or no insult, students or no students, wife or no wife, I am staying.
Oh, but why? What in God's name do you think you can do here now?
Be an old nuisance. Make senile mischief. Throw large spanners into their godless works. Yes, I'll grab the pick of the history honours people and show them what life's done so far with this gaudy little planet. I'll contradict every dreary little lie about humanity that Pierce and Saxon and the rest can cook up.
Don't go on, Robert, because I think you're bluffing.
Do you, Alfred?
I'm sorry. Even if I thought that, I oughtn't to have said it.
Well, if you can think it, then you better say it. Even tonight. Perhaps I was bluffing a bit. Whistling in the dark, perhaps. Look, let's put it like this. I've been here a long time. I like the glum, mucky old place. Times are hard, Alfred. We've got to keep on if we can. And there might be something I could help to do here before the light goes. A touch of colour, hint of wonder. It's not so much men as machines we have to beat. I was telling my family, who don't care a damn, that we're trying to do a wonderful thing here, but not in a wonderful way. There's a kind of grey, chilly hollowness inside when there ought to be gaiety, colour, warmth, vision. Sometimes our great common enterprise seems only a noble skeleton. My wife and family tell me to go away and enjoy myself, but doing what? Watching the fire die out of the heart? Never even stooping to blow? Here in Burmanley with Dinah and her kind and a few friends and allies, I can still blow a little. Brighten an ember or two.
The young and the old are the best now, Robert. There's a lot of rotten dead stuff in the middle.
Yeah, perhaps there always was. And the young and the old were always the best.
Mm.
Nearer the door in and the door out. And with more spirit to spare. Oh, the world's too much with the middles. We're busy looking for promotion and a seat on the board.
Robert, you look tired. Cold, too. Go to bed and don't bother seeing me out.
Damn it, man, I'm 65, not 85.
Good night, Robert.
Daddy?
Oh, hello, Dinah. Thought you'd gone to bed.
I started, but... Well, you looked so miserable sitting there.
I was brooding a bit. There are times when...
Yes?
Oh, well, let's just say there are times. Leave it at that. Here, young woman, settling down. You ought to be in bed.
Will you do something specially to please me?
I might.
But do you remember? You read us once a bit of that book on history you started writing.
Mm-hmm.
Will you read some of it again? The beginning.
You don't want that stuff.
Oh, I do. I need it. You need it. And if we don't have it, well, I'll go to bed and be miserable. And you'll go on being broody and lonely down here. So please.
Oh, all right then. That's if I can find the thing. Ah, yes. Here it is.
Oh, good.
Now then, let's see. History, to be worthy of the name, should bring us a stereoscopic view of man's life. Without that extra dimension, strangely poignant as well as vivid, it is flat. And because it is flat, it is false. There are two patterns endlessly being superimposed on one another. The first pattern is that of man reproducing himself, finding food and shelter, tilling the land, building cities, crossing the seas. It is the picture we understand now with ease, perhaps too easily. For the other pattern is still there, waiting to be interpreted. It is the record of man as a spiritual creature, with a whole world of unknown continents and strange seas, gardens of paradise, and cities lit with hellfire within the depths of his own soul. History that ignores the god and the altar is as false as history that could forget the sword and the wheel. Nor does the former belong only... Dinah. Fast asleep. What was that? Nor does the former... No, I don't like former. Cross it out. Can't imagine how I came to write it. Belong only to the first youth of civilization. For we find that...
In The Linden Tree by J.B. Priestley, Professor Linden was played by Geoffrey Banks. Isabel, his wife, by Kathleen Helme. Rex Linden by Christopher Godwin. And Dr. Jean Linden by Carole Hayman. Marion de Saint-Vaury was Joanna Wake. Dinah Linden, Penelope Reynolds. Alfred Lockhart, David Marlowe. And Edith Westmore, Sally Gibson. Bernard Fawcett was Christian Rodska. And Mrs. Cotton, Shirley Dixon.